Hello and welcome.
Today we'll dive into the exciting world of microphone specifications.
Sometimes they seem complicated, but they aren't rocket science and can be really helpful.
In this video, we'll learn about sensitivity,
how to set up your own mic shootout the right way,
and why you can't trust all frequency charts. Okay, so let's start. Sensitivity.
First of all, it doesn't mean how likely your mic is to cry when you hurt its feelings. I think we chose the wrong mic.
All right. So, the sensitivity of a mic tells you how much output you get for your input.
If your mic sensitivity is high, you will need less gain from a preamp to achieve a certain output level.
Here we have two different microphones, a condenser and a dynamic microphone. This one here is a condenser mic, the LCT540S, and we designed it to capture a lot of detail.
It's a large diaphragm condenser microphone with high sensitivity.
And it's great for recording vocals, instruments, ASMR, and making Foley recordings.
The second mic is a dynamic instrument mic, the MTP440DM.
Dynamic mics generally feature a lower sensitivity.
And some models need tons of gain if you want to use them for recording vocals.
This condenser mic has a sensitivity of 41 millivolts per Pascal or minus 28 dBV per Pascal.
The dynamic mic, on the other hand, has a lower sensitivity of 2.5 millivolts per Pascal or minus 52 dBV per Pascal. But what does that mean?
Good question. Well, it means that a certain output is produced when the mic is exposed to a sound pressure level of 1 Pascal. In the case of the condenser, that's 41 millivolts, or in other words, minus 28 dBV.
Nerd fact, 1 Pascal equals 94 dB SPL.
And fun fact, 0 dB SPL equals 0.00002 Pascal. Yes, microphones do output a voltage, but the world of recording uses the dB scale frequently, which is why we will focus on dBV.
It also allows you to compare mics more easily. For example, the dynamic mic needs an extra 24 dB of gain to reach the same output level as the condenser.
All right, let's check out the difference in sensitivity between the two mics. First, we'll set them to the exact same gain levels on our preamp.
Check, check, 1, 2. This is the dynamic instrument microphone with the low sensitivity. And this is the large diaphragm condenser microphone with the high sensitivity. Can you hear the difference?
So, as expected, the difference in level between the two microphones is pretty obvious. Let's adjust the gain to level match the output so that we can hear how they actually sound different to each other.
This is an absolute must if you're comparing two mics in a shootout, and we'll show you how to do your own in a minute.
So, let's say you want to find your new vocal mic. Always adjust the gain to compensate for different sensitivities.
Because in general, louder always sounds better. If you don't take this into account, you can't make the best decision.
Also keep this in mind when comparing different takes, actually.
Level matching is the only true way to make an informed decision.
And if you really want to go the extra mile, you'd set up a test environment where you can be sure that your mics have been level matched.
And this is how you do it. Take a speaker and place the mics you want to compare in front of it. Make sure that the distance is the same between the capsule and the speaker membrane.
Look for a signal generator and play a lovely 1 kHz sound.
Adjust the gain of both mics until the input level meter in your DAW shows the exact same value.
Alright, let's listen to both of our mics with the adjusted gain.
Check, check, 1, 2. This is the dynamic instrument microphone with the low sensitivity, and this is the large diaphragm condenser microphone with the high sensitivity. Can you hear the difference?
There are two more things that are directly linked to sensitivity: the frequency response and the polar pattern.
The polar graph tells you the sensitivity at certain frequencies for different angles.
One might forget this because we tend to just look at the 1 kHz polar graph. FYI, there's more to a polar pattern than just the 1 kHz reading.
Polar patterns have different directional properties at different frequencies.
As you can see, this cardioid opens up and becomes less directional at lower frequencies.
And more directional at high frequencies.
The frequency response chart shows you which frequencies the mic is most sensitive to and the ones that are picked up less efficiently.
There is a standard how they need to look like.
For graphs in which a level in decibels is plotted against a frequency on a logarithmic scale, the scale proportions shall be those for which a 10 to 1 frequency ratio is equal to the length of a level of 50 dB on the ordinate scale.
Wow! Or simply put, the distance between a frequency and the frequency times 10 must be equal to 50 dB on the vertical axis.
Yeah. Hmm? Looking at the frequency chart gives you a first impression of what a microphone might sound like, but keep in mind that it's measured under standardized conditions that differ greatly from a typical recording scenario.
Most manufacturers provide you with a frequency chart, but be aware of smoothing. It's a bit like statistics. There's always a favorable way to represent your data.
Mm-hmm. Smoothing makes sense if you don't overdo it, but it also has its purposes, of course.
Now, let's say you're looking for a new mic. Which one would you choose? A or B?
You probably guessed it already. They're actually the same. We just use different scales to state the frequency response.
One might look nicer, but the other one tells you a lot more about how your mic might sound. Heavily skewed data might work better for marketing or sales purposes, but it doesn't really provide substantial information.
That's why we choose to provide frequency charts and microphone specifications that actually allow you to make an informed decision.
That's how we roll.
We hope you learned something today.
Please let us know if you have any questions in the comments below.
Until next time,
make yourself heard.